there. My name is Gisèle Grenier and I'm a mixed media and portrait artist living in Ontario, Canada. Welcome to my studio. Today you will learn how to create the two paintings shown on the screen. The art kit that you have includes a set of step-by-step instructions, but in this video you will have the opportunity to learn a variety of additional techniques to help you along. Now at the end of the video there will be some information on how you can access a large number of free tutorials and additional workshops on my website. So let's get started and move over to the painting table. I've put out some reference material that I use to create the actual project, and you can see that I did quite a few samples. First thing I did is I searched out some photographs, and I found some photographs that really inspired me. I like the tree on this one. I like the shape of the rolling hills. This one I was partial to a little bit of the color, so I used all these three. I did some sketches and then I did my first post shot. Now, post shot is a quick study sketch and it's useful to play with colors and composition. I kind of liked a very, very fast sketch, a watercolor sketch. And then I was starting to play a little bit more with form. You can tell I didn't really play with the tree here. I was looking more for the color, and I was okay with the color. I have my sky mix done. Then in another set, then I started playing a bit more with the tree form, and I really like what I had with the tree. You can tell I didn't really do much with the mountain. I was more for the tree and playing with different greens and for the foreground. And then I ended up with this one. So I have that, which was more structured, but then I cropped it down to something like that. And what you have as a reference project may look a little bit, a reference material may look a little bit different than this, but I just want to show you that although I painted this full size, you can still crop it down even further. Okay, so we're going to be working with this as the formal reference piece. But it's always great to have multiple versions. You can tell, you know, different versions of the same composition, and they all turned out a little bit differently. So we're going to start with a piece of watercolor paper, and you can choose to do the design in a portrait style or a landscape style. The primary focus is the tree, so I'm going to do it this way. And just grab my original, and just to show you that I'm really even cropping it down even further. It's up to you how much paper you want to use. So I'm going to use a small piece of paper. This is about 8 by 11, I believe. 8 by 10, 8 by 11. And just try to leave, if you're going to frame this with a border, just leave about a quarter of an inch overhang. So don't put any details a quarter of an inch to the edge. But watercolors do need to be framed behind glass for protection, because watercolors are not permanent. They're water soluble. So if your painting, once it's finished, got wet, then the marks would show. To start off, I put out a small amount of sap green and Prussian blue, and I've dampened my brushes. Now the brushes that you have, that you'll be using, may be different than what I have. I'm just using large watercolor brushes. And when I call out the brushes, I'll be calling out large flat, small flat, big round, little round. Okay, so we're going to use the large flat brush. With watercolors, all artists have different styles of how they apply the watercolor. I'm going to show you the style that I use to teach beginners with watercolors that's fairly easy to work with. So I'm going to use a large flat brush and just dampen the paper. You can dampen the paper this way. You can also use a little misting brush, misting bottle, and just spray. Whatever is more convenient for you. I don't know if you'll be able to see. So you see how the water's on there, but see how it's irregular? You need to make sure that it's completely covered. And if you're going to do what I do with my hands, I always use my hands, and I thought, oh, I better tell you first, make sure your hands are clean. But the misting bottle is something you should have anyways, and you probably have an empty bottle around the house that you can use. And I got a little bit of Prussian blue on there already. Take a look. The paper should be wet, but not dripping. Okay. Now we're going to dampen the brush again. Then we're going to pull out a little bit of Prussian blue and make sure it's nice and fluid. Now, anywhere that you want the watercolor to distribute, this should be wet. And I covered the whole thing, and I'm going to apply the paint with the flat brush, just going across. Okay, like so. And I'm going to work about a quarter of the way down. And I'm going to take the brush, and I'm just going to put some areas like this, leave some white areas showing, because we're going to use the paper towel to pull out some clouds. And I'm just going to just freehand the hills, like so. Bring that down a little bit more, like that. You want the color to be darker at the top. Okay, then I'm just going to tilt the paper a little bit this way. The paint will start to run down slightly. If your paper is just damp, it'll be fine. And take a clean crumpled paper towel. Now when I crumple it, I like using the edges right like this. Okay, and you're just going to pad some clouds like that. Okay, there we go. And if you happen to have removed too much, I removed a little bit too much here, and come back with a little bit more paint and just repaint the bottom of the sky. And then just pad out the cloud. And because that area is so small, I'm just going to roll the paper towel to a little bit smaller and just put it in that way. And I'm going to use the edge of the brush. I can reshape the cloud like so to make it look like there's a nice edge. But this looks like the sky's on top of the cloud, so then I'm going to use my paper towel just to soften it. Okay, like that. The clouds are usually fluffier at the top, and they blend into the sky at the bottom. Like that. Okay. Now, we need to let this dry, because if we were just to start painting the mountain right away, because this is wet and this is wet, the violet color would actually blend into the sky, and we don't want that. So we want to let this dry. And if you have a hair blower, you can use your hair blower about 12 inches away. Constantly move your hand back and forth. That will speed up the drying time. You can let it dry naturally. You'll get different effects. So if you have an art journal or just a pad of watercolor paper, it's always good to, you know, practice your stroke, let it dry naturally, then practice the strokes again, drying with a hair dryer just to see what happens. I have a heat gun, which I use because the air pressure is a lot lower, but it's much hotter, so I put it up really, really high to dry it. I've added violet to my palette, and I'm just rinsing out my brush. And what we want to do now when I'm doing this, and there's still a little bit of violet Prussian blue in the brush, that doesn't matter. The colors that we're using are all together on the color wheel, so they won't create mud if mixed together. So I'm just dampening the bottom section only. And I have to look at it on a bit of an angle because the studio lights, all that shows me is glare. Now when you're creating the edge for the mountain, make sure you're nice and crisp line, because the watercolor will flow to that edge. Just really making sure that I have that covered. Then I'm going to dilute a little bit of violet. And we're going to start at the top edge, and we're going to go stroke the mountains like this and then work down. Okay, and we're going to work that down a little bit. Now when you're creating the mountains, how you apply the paint has a lot to do with the ending resulting stroke. Now I don't know if you can see that. The paint is starting to go towards the sky. I want to make sure I don't have a glow there. So I'm going to go a little bit closer. Work slowly. We're not in any hurry. I'm going to tilt the paper towards me. Because I don't want the paint running into the sky. Like so. You see how it's dripping? Now I'm just going to soften it and I'm going to blot my brush on a paper towel. And now, every time you blot your brush on a paper towel, you're lifting up the paint. And this is how we create some highlights. I'm going to rinse my brush, blot it again. And every time you blot, your brush becomes drier and drier. And I'm just going to feather the paint out to the bottom. I'm going to rinse that out. Now you can see here where the mountain touched the sky a little bit, but here it's a little bit softer, which is fine. I'm just going to create some few little highlights here, and as I would keep brushing over the area with the dry brush and it's removing the paint, it's creating a light. Now I can go like this. That makes it looks like there's a ridge there. Like that. See that? And then there's a hill here, so I can do something like that just to create a little bit of motion. The mountains are not the primary focus of the piece. It's the actual the tree. Now if I take a little bit of water in my brush and blot again, the water helps me get a little bit of a stronger effect, because it's diluting the paint even more. Just be careful when you do that. I can also use my paper towel. Now this you have to be careful with, because you can accidentally remove too much. I'm going to remove a little bit more than I intend to, just to show you how to fix it. Okay. We'll remove. We'll pretend we removed a whole bunch there. Okay, so I went a little crazy and I removed too much paint. But what do? We don't need to re-wet the piece. We just need to pick up some diluted paint. Come back. Tilt your paper a little bit. Okay, and I want to create a little bit of a effect right here, like so. And tilting the paper helps gravity pull the paint down so it doesn't accidentally go into the sky. There you go, like that. So you can leave it like that, or you can play with it some more. I would suggest playing a little bit more with your in your art journal on scrap paper. Then we can go back, blot the brush, and then we can manipulate the paint. So. Now, if you had a dry brush, or you know, you can use your round brush, not so much a dry brush, it's just barely dry. I just made it a little bit flatter. And you can do that as well. It's all about playing and experimenting. Oh, I really like that. Okay, I'm not gonna play with that anymore. I don't wanna ruin it. I really like that. So we'll leave that and just rinse the brush again. And now we're gonna let that dry. I added a little bit more violet here. When I was drying it, it became a little bit too light. So I just added a little bit more violet, brought it down. And now we're going to use our flat brush again. I'm going to pick up a speck of burnt sienna. Just bring that in here. And a little bit of Prussian blue. What I'm looking for is a dull gray mix. And you might be tempted to use, black, but burnt sienna, because it's a reddish brown, it won't dull down the intensity of the blue. That's actually a really nice gray right there. Okay, rinse my brush, and now we're going to paint the background mountains. And same technique as this, we're going to use our brush that's wet, and you're just going to freestyle it. And we'll come up here. Down. I'm going to go opposite so I don't have a pattern. Like that. Then I'm going to wet the rest of the paper. Make sure that this, though, is dry, because the watercolor will follow wherever the paper is wet. I'm going to use this mixture, and we're just going to paint along. The other thing that you can do too, now this is, I would suggest that you practice this, is paint on dry paper, where you don't wet it first. That's called wet on dry. I'm going to tilt the paper a little bit. And if you find that, let's see if I can recreate it with this. So as we're painting, and the paint is flowing, and you really won't know until it's dry. If it's not dark enough, just wet it again and then add another layer. You can also add another layer at this point. So if I take a little bit more Prussian blue, and be careful when you do this so you don't splash your painting. A little bit more burnt sienna. Less water. And I'm going to come in. Add just a little bit more paint. And bring that here. Now I want to show you with a heat gun. Now it's going to get a little bit noisy. I'm going to show you with my heat gun. And it's just a heat gun like this. I have to hold it up really high, but I want to show you what happens when you dry it, how I dry it. I'm going to tilt the paper up a bit, and I'm going to use the heat gun this way. By using the heat gun on an angle, I'm still pushing the paint this way. If I were to dry it this way, if the paper is too wet, then it'll push the watercolor up into the mountain. Checking to make sure it's not too hot. And there we are. So you can see how the color changed a bit. Now this is still a little bit damp, Now, if I wanted to correct some of that, depending on how tight the detail is, I really want to get a much finer line. I can use my round brush and a little bit more paint. Now the round brush holds a lot of paint. Just make sure it's not too watery. And I'm just gonna touch it onto the paper towel just to clean it up a bit. And now I come in here. This is wet on dry. You get a much cleaner edge. Okay, that's wet on dry. And before anything has time to dry, I'm gonna come in I'm just gonna drag the brush over. I'm gonna pick up a little bit of water, and a little bit of water is just to touch the paint on the edge. I don't want the paint to dry with that really hard edge, but see that? A little bit more water. And when I'm touching on the paper towel, all I'm doing is doing this. It just pulls out the excess water from the tip of the brush. See this here? That's a dried water spot right there. We want to get rid of those. And how you get rid of those is by drying. Now, I'm going to have another foreground piece here, so that's why I'm showing this technique. I'm just showing you how to do different things. So I can even, while I'm here, I can sketch out where I'm going to be painting that hill, because I can see something appearing. Okay. So wet on dry. There we go. And bring down that paint a little bit more. And if I wanted to, I can use my paper towel. I can use my paper towel to blot up some areas here, like so. Okay. Take my paintbrush again and say, okay, well, because the tree is going to be here, this is now a lot more blue instead of the gray. Sorry, it's a lot more gray. This one's more blue. I could turn around and say, well, if I'm gonna have a tree here that's gonna be dark, I can leave this light. That's fine. I can bring a little bit more paint in here and darken this up here because this is going to be in view. You just manipulate the paint. And it just takes practice, but it's a lot of fun. Unlike acrylics, where if you make a boo-boo, you could just cover it up. With watercolors, you can't really. You just have to try to lift it up, lift up the color. And use the damp brushes with water and just pick up the excess paint. There's going to be a tree here, so it doesn't matter. Like so. Now you've got some nice action there. Okay. You can bring the paint down a little bit more. It's all about manipulating the paint. Don't fiddle with it too much though, because you want to let it dry and move on and practice some more. So now we're going to let this dry. So now that's had time to dry, I'm going to create the foreground rolling hill. So this is now this brown hill here. And I'm going to use our flat brush, dampen the brush. And we're just going to lay that out, and I'm going to come out this way, like so, and then paint that. You know what, I think I'm going to bring that a little bit higher, like that, bring that up there. And wet that towards the bottom of the paper. take a look to see what's wet. Yep, that's actually pretty good. Let me change the shape there. Okay, and all we're going to do is use burnt umber with a little bit of burnt sienna. Just making a reddish brown, a little bit of water. And we're going to bring that in there. Now, because we already have a color underneath, that's going to help with the color application. That's why I added a little bit of burnt umber, just to make it a little bit more neutral. I'm going to paint that all the way to the bottom. And that's going to be a little bit light for me. A little bit more paint. Now, see that stroke that happened there? That's because I didn't dilute the paint on the palette well enough. It's just a big glob of physical paint. If that happens, you just redistribute it in your palette, and then you can brush it out. Okay, like so. And I'm just going to put a little bit more of the red in here. This is the burnt sienna only. Not too much happening here because this is just a background, a rolling hill. Okay, we'll leave that. And we'll dry that, and then we can come back and we can apply another layer to make it darker. So it's dried now, and it's still not dark enough. As things become forward, they need to be a little bit darker. So I'm gonna create another mixture, same mixture, burnt sienna and burnt umber. But I'm gonna show you now, we're gonna do this dry. Okay, so got, I don't know if you can see, big glob of, you probably can't see, big glob of burnt sienna there. Make sure it's all blended in there. You know what, I'm going to touch in a little bit of Prussian blue in there as well. And that ends up being a little bit more on the green side. Come in. Now, doing this dry, you can see I can get much finer detail. Wet paint on dry paper. Detailed much finer. But then I need to add some water so the paint will flow downwards. There are some situations where you want that hard edge. Just depends on what you're painting. Okay. Now I'm going to lighten this up a little bit. I just want to show you the technique because I don't want the tree to be lost, so that you can, so then that could be the background. So remember how we lighten up an area, blot the brush, go back over. Blot the brush. Okay. Now your mountains will be a different shape than mine, which is totally fine. You do not have to make them the same shape. Okay, then I'm going to rinse my brush, blot it again, come back. You can also use the round brush. Make sure you rinse your brushes first in clean water before you use them to play with, to experiment. And just wiping out the paint just to lighten the area out. Leave that area like so. Bring some of that paint down. Just manipulate. As long as it's wet, you can manipulate it. Okay, I like that. If I wanted to take advantage of that, put my brush into a little bit more paint. I want to take advantage of that. I really like that effect. There we go. I like that look. There we are. I'm just going to wipe up some of the paint on the bottom. And what I'm doing now is I'm going to do a wet brush sketch. You don't have to do this. It's just a technique I'm showing you. And I'm just using the round brush now just to pre-plan where I'm going to be putting the grass area. So I think I'm going to put it. You could also use your paper towel. The paper towel, you don't have as much control. So just be careful. You do that. So I've got the little, there's a little bit green grass here, then the hill. And it comes down like so. Okay. So we'll let that dry. Then we'll come in and we'll move on to the next step. So I laid out some dark green, and we're going to sketch out our tree. And this is done freestyle. If you prefer practicing in a journal with your pencil, that's fine. I'm going to use a large brush. Dampen it in water, blot it, and we're just going to create a thin mixture of green. Now the paint on the palette is starting to dry out. You can mist it or just kind of push your brush into it. Watercolors can be reconstituted with water. And we want this to be fairly light, so really, really watery, because we're going to be doing a sketch. That paint over there. Okay, nice and watery. Holds a lot of moisture, this brush. Okay, I'm just going to tip it on the edge. And we're going to create our sketch with our brush. Again, if you want to use your pencil, that's fine. Just keep in mind that pencil will show through the watercolor. And I can start at the top here, or I can start at the bottom. It doesn't really matter. The easier way to do it is to come in here, touch, push, pull. If you're doing it upside down, pull it towards you and start to lift the brush up. Lift, 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 like that. Okay, and it's fine if it's on an angle. I don't like perfectly straight trees. Okay. So once you've got that shape pretty well set, you can take your brush again and then come in and just create dry. This is dry. I did not wet the paper first. And create some little branches. And we're just getting the structure of the tree set up. And this helps you so you don't have a triangle shaped tree. You have some movement in and out. And I'm going to show you what that means. So I'm just creating some make that a little bit more tapered. And it should go almost to the top. And that's actually pretty good. Okay, that's pretty good. And once you've got that set, you are going to be able to see inside the tree, which is fine. We're going to be covering that up. So get your tree about set to that point. And then let it dry, and then we're going to start building on top of that. We're going to move to the small brush now, small round brush, and we're going to get into painting some shadows in the tree. So we're going to use Prussian blue and really wet that. Nice and diluted. Again, load the brush. I'm just going to tip the end. And we're going to create some shadows. So I'm going to come in here and I'm basically going to be going over some of the branches, really painting that in here. This is going to be fairly dark in here. I'm going to do it with multiple layers. So the left side of the tree is more shadowed. I can also use this opportunity just to add a few more branches. I just want to get that shadowed in there like so. I'm just going to come in, add a few more branches. These are just going to create, it's going to create some extra shadows when we apply the green. And just a little bit here, not too much. It's more on the bottom. There are some shadows even on the highlighted side. Okay, and then if I want to hit this with a hairdryer, like you can let it dry naturally, but to save time, I'm going to hit this with the heat gun. And all I'm focusing on is this spot right here to show you. Okay, I can come back with a little bit more Prussian blue. Now I'm going to go into a little bit of burnt sienna. You don't have to. This is just an alternative to show you. And I can come back and I can just darken a certain spot. Okay. And what it is just to, we will eventually, we'll lose the line of the mountain showing through the tree. But you can't just put dark here, dark here, and dark here. So we're going to blend that in. So do this step very slowly. I'm kind of straggling that around like that. Okay, and let's bring that up a little bit here. So just an extra I love trees. I love drawing trees. Okay, let's get a little bit of darkness here as well. And then what we're going to do when we start actually painting in the tree, we're going to be painting around these so the tree will have some nice form. Now, I'm showing you a technique. If you wanted to stop at a certain point and you'd like the tree the way it is, then stop. That's your painting. I'm just showing you techniques. Okay, so I think what I want to do now, and I want to let this dry naturally, and I want to start working a little bit on the foreground. So I'm going to use a small brush again, and I'm going to use this mixture here, this green mixture. If you don't have any paint left, let's say you've come back after a little while, you can use sap green, a little bit of Prussian blue, but I'm going to reuse this paint right here and create a little puddle. Pick up a little bit of Prussian blue, not too much. All we're doing is just, in a fancy art term, we're bluing up the paint. That doesn't make any sense, does it? Bluing up. Okay. And have a paper towel ready, and all we're going to do is where we have our tree line here, all I'm going to do is just like a little shaky hand like this, and wherever that edge is, this is just the start of creating our foreground. And oops, that's too much paint. So this is where you would blot it. Okay? Because I forgot to do this. By blotting the paint on your paper towel first, it just helps in case you have just too much of a blob. So even this is a little bit heavy. Blot, blot. Okay? Because we have... we're going to be creating some little background trees in here. We're going to end up losing a lot of this as well, so don't worry about that. You know what? That's a little bit too blue for me. I'm just gonna put a little bit more green in there. There we go. Let's just feather that out. I should have cleaned that up a little bit better. We have that line where it dried. There's nothing I can do about it now. I can keep rubbing and rubbing and rubbing. If you keep rubbing and rubbing, you're eventually gonna start pulling off the top layer of the paper. So don't worry about it too much. Okay. Then you just have to let this dry just for a few minutes. Not too much, because now we're gonna actually start putting some of the actual dirt layer under the tree. We're going to use the large round brush, and we're going to load it with a little bit of diluted burnt sienna. Okay. Then I'm going to blot the excess out and turn that. You're creating a little bit of a sketch, just rough, like so. Dry paper. Okay. I want to bring that right up into the tree. And I will have to do a little bit of correction work in here so I get rid of that big stroke of Prussian blue, which is fine. Now the tree is more heavily shadowed on this side. And just create a little bit of a stroke there, just like that. Okay, now you can either let the piece dry now, or you can work on the rest of the tree while that's drying. We're going to start painting around here now. And to do that, we're going to use a large brown brush. And we're going to put out some lemon yellow on the palette. Now, my palette is getting a little bit messy. To solve that problem, all I'm going to do is just pick up some of the paint like this. You want your paints to be fresh, especially when we're working with yellows. Now you can also get watercolor palettes as well. I have one, but it's really, really messy. And it's like this. Okay. And I try to keep my colors separate. So my blues here, reds here, greens, yellows, really light colors. But that's, and see how all this is dry? All I gotta do is add some water to it, and it will reconstitute, and I can use it again. It's always nice, though, working with fresh paint on the palette. Fresh paper towel. And I guess some lemon yellow. That right here. And you don't need that much paint, just for video purposes. And put some water on there. And I'm just gonna grab some sap green and a little bit of yellow on the side. That's not bad. Okay. So we're gonna start now with this touch. Now, if you don't see me do that, I'll usually do it. I have a paper towel way over there, and I'm using that to blot up all my paint. I try to keep brush work on the palette, and normally my palette wouldn't be this close to the painting in case you have splashback. I got a little bit of splash here. So with that, now you're going to come in here, and you're just going to use this brush, and you're going to start tapping in and start working around. And the tree is going to be more yellow on the right side and more green on the left side, but that doesn't mean you have to do yellow green. We're going to work the whole tree with the yellow, and then we can tap in a little bit of green and go from there. So I'm just gonna come in here. Okay, and so I'm just gonna go around, and I'm again scribbling. A generic shape. And you notice that I'm going in and out, and that creates for an interesting tree. You don't want a tree that's a perfectly shaped triangle tree. I call that the Charlie Brown Christmas tree at the end when they decorated it. We don't want... I do have a Charlie Brown Christmas tree, by the way. A little stick with three branches in the yellow ball. Just come around here. Like so. Okay. And you can tell I started running out of paint in here. And I can come in now. I'm going to pick up just a bit of the green. And come in here. And you know what I didn't do? I didn't blot my brush. Because look at this big glob of paint that just came out. There we go. Now we're also working wet on wet. So now when we're putting on the green, it's going to the area that the yellow was applied. We eventually want it to look like that. And some of my beginner students, I could hear them right now, ones that have only taken a couple of my lessons, would say, oh, you can see the mountain through the trees. Well, once we start putting some more color in, that eventually will disappear. But you can, in trees, depending on how leafy they are, you can see through them. So you don't want to take that away from the design. But eventually you see how we're starting to apply the color. It does disappear. And I want to make this a little bit more on the yellow-green side. So I'm just going to come with a little bit more paint. Now see how dry that is? This has now had time to dry. That's a little bit too dry for me. I'm going to put a little bit more water in there. Blot. And spread that out. Very different effect when you're painting on dry paper versus wet paper. We want to make sure that we've gone over, and you'll really see the shape that your tree is once everything is dry. See how I'm doing here? I'm just kind of putting some little pointy doodads in there. That's actually beautiful the way it is. If I was doing this on my own, like for myself, I would stop right here because I am absolutely loving this tree just the way it is. For the lesson, I am going to show you how to add some darker pockets of shadow, okay? But for the record, I would leave the tree as it is right now. I wouldn't do anything else with it. Okay, I'm going to bring in, though, a little bit of sap green. Into dark green and sap green. And I'm just going to touch in a little bit of darkness right here. And this is still wet, so you can see that the paint is just blooming outwards. And I'm touching it where the branches are. That. And this part here works really nice when the paint is already wet. And I'm just going to come in just a little bit on the bottom section here, where the branches are. I'm not going to go right out to the edge the way I did here, because I want to give the tree the opportunity to dry first before I do any more with it. That is absolutely gorgeous. Oh my goodness. Sometimes when you do something really nice that you're happy with, give yourself a pat on the back. Touch, touch. What I'm really liking about this is this area here is unpainted. I love that. Absolutely love that. Okay, I'm gonna stop. So I think now I'm looking at this and we are at the point now. You know what? I'm going to let this dry just for a smidgen because some of the work that I want to do, I don't want to lose the detail in this. The next step, you can go on without letting the tree dry. I just don't want to lose the effects that what I'm going to get, because basically at the point that we're at now, we will use some green and brown to create some darker pockets of shadows in the tree. And that's detail work. Now, if your tree is at a point where you really like it, then leave it. And then just watch the next step before you decide if you want to add in the darker pockets of brown. We can do the step with the round brush or the small brush. I'm going to do this with the small brush. I really don't want to. I like what I have, but I'm going to show it to you for technique. I'm going to take some of the dark green and burnt sienna. And it's going to create a dark, very dark mixture. And you want it fairly diluted. You want to make sure it's darker than what's on there now. And I'm going to test it first. Now, my tree is still wet. And all I'm doing is creating, I'm touching in some darker pockets. I'm not everywhere. Not everywhere. Now, what happens if your tree, if you let your tree dry, then you can go over with your large brush and water and just kind of go around just to dampen it. And I can tilt my paper to make sure that the paint flows in the direction that I want it to. Like I said, I like what I have here and I really don't want to do any more. But just to show you the technique. You're gonna have less of the dark stuff up here because the tree is much more airy. Where you're gonna have the darkness is going to be right in here. And then right where the tree trunk is in some spots, you put some paint right over the tree trunk. Now I'm not liking that, so I'm gonna spread that out a little bit more. In some parts of a tree, if you look at it, you can see through the tree and see the tree trunk, and some parts you can't. And let's get a little bit of shadow in here, not too much, because the tree is highlighted on this side, but we want to make sure that it's even. I'm going to need a little bit more paint. Now I'm going to create this now with sap green. Just sap green by itself. And let's see, because I don't want to make it too dark. Yeah, the sap green works out fine. And I'm just going to put a little bit more paint around there, and I'm going to turn this, and I'm just going to kind of not jab into the paper, but just to create some leafiness the way I did here. Now, this here is dry. That's a bit too much paint. Oh, you know what? I really like that. See, as soon as I turn the paper around, okay, I'm not going to touch that. I like that. And the shape of the tree, I think, is what's really doing it for me. I love the shape of the tree. And I'm going to bring this out just a little bit more. Jab, jab, jab. Oh, yeah. Now, I have some videos. All the information will be at the end of this video, but I do have some tutorials, free tutorials and stuff like that for creating different elements, trees, and you know, what have you, and you're more than welcome to watch that. I've got a YouTube channel as well, a blog. I really like that. Just touch, touch. And typically, a tree is tapered at the top and it gets wider at the bottom, depending on the tree you're painting. Some trees are different and they don't look like that. Now, see how we made that wet that we can actually see that line there? I don't care because the tree is much airier at the bottom. But I do just want to darken this part right here. I'm just creating some dark, just a few dark pockets, but the tree is much lighter on that side. I'm going to rinse my brush with just a little bit of water. I'm just going to water some of the edges just to make it look even airier. I like that. Really like that. Nice little air pockets in here. Okay, that could be where a little squirrel lives. Alrighty. So I believe now we're at the point where I want to do a little bit of work on the ground. And we don't need to let this dry. We can start right away. I can use, I'm going to use my let me use my flat brush and just with some burnt sienna. And I'm just going to touch some burnt sienna in here. Just make this part a little bit darker. And this will be the shadow for the tree. Like that. And come in here. Now this will be completely unique to what you're doing. What I'm doing now doesn't even match the line drawing because it'll all be different. I can do this painting 25 times and I'll have 25 different versions of it. Okay, I'm going to leave that like that. And I want to start putting a little bit of green. I'm going to let this dry just a little bit though. Let me just let it dry naturally for video purposes. Because I'm limited on time, I'm going to use the heat gun, and I just want to dry the bottom section here. And rinse my brush. And you can use white with sap green, but I'm going to see what if I can get it just with the sap green by itself. And just touch in there. It's a little bright. But I'm going to let it dry first before I make any decisions. But if you have a lot of paper that's unpainted, you can use a little bit of white in there. And the white, all it does is it makes the paint more look a little bit more chalky. I'm not a fan of using white when it comes to watercolor. But I'll show you what it looks like. It just makes it look a little bit chalkier. Again, not a fan of white, but try it and see. Okay, because we'll want to overlay a little bit of yellow after that. So at this point now, I want to let everything dry. So everything's had a chance to dry, and although it's not necessary for my tree because I want to leave it, but I'm going to show it for technique. I'm going to show you. You can take, if your tree is too dark with watercolors, you can try lifting it out, but that may not always work. We can use some lemon yellow and paint over the entire tree. And I'm going to use the small brush for this. And just use a little bit of lemon yellow. Not too thin. And you can just lay it on the dry paper. Now the more layers of paint that you put on here, the more opaque it's going to be. You'll see less and less of what's underneath. So just be careful how much of the yellow that you add. But this is a really good way to add a little bit of brightness to your piece. I don't know if you can even see that. There we go. Okay. And I can just come across as well. Because it is transparent. I personally would not have done anything to the tree because I like the tree the way it was, but I just want to show you the technique. Okay. And then on the flip side, if the side was too light, you can then darken it with just a little bit of Prussian blue. And with that, or Prussian blue with a little bit of green, the sap green even. Just be careful when how much of this you use, and then you can come in and just put a little bit of this in here. You can even go over a little bit of the yellow. Okay. Just be careful how much Prussian blue you use. Just put a little bit in here. Do it nice and slow. And if you if you're not sure about something, let it dry before adding any more paint. You can do a little bit of this. I can add a little bit in here. Now this may not, you may not need to do this, and if you like the tree the way it is, then leave it. I'm just showing you the technique. Okay? But what we can do now is the tree trunk here, I want to firm up the edge. Now, I absolutely love that shadow there. But I need to highlight this a little bit more. Now this is where you could use white. And for that, I'm gonna take white. Now you can highlight this white with blue or white with brown. It's up to you. But because for me the shadowing is more on the blue side, I can use a little bit of Prussian blue, and I should not have put it there. Never do a paint mix next to your white. Never do a paint mix next to your white, because you could contaminate the white. That's even too strong. So I'm going to bring more white and just go on the side. Okay. So you could do it like that. So if you like, so if your shadow is more, more on the blue side, you could just take that same mix with just a bit more white. But if your shadow is more on the brown side, then you can take, let's say, burnt umber or burnt sienna. But try it in your, some scrap paper first. And all I'm going to do on the dry paper, is just that. Then just wipe the excess out of the brush and just slowly push the paint into the side like that. Okay, rinse the brush, blot it, and just pull the paint. Now I don't believe I put that into the lesson. I want to show you how you can further deepen a shadow. So what I'm doing now is I'm over highlighting to show you what to do. So you're just going to do the highlight over here. I'm over highlighting and I say, oh no, what do? I put way too much white on there. How do I fix that? I like using purple for a shadow. So if I could take a little bit of purple, but that's too strong by itself. So a little bit of purple or violet, a little bit of burnt umber. And all I want to do is knock down the vibrancy of that. That's actually pretty good here. Blot the brush. And then you can do this while it's wet, and then just come back and just add a little bit of that in there. Remember how I was worried about fixing that part in the bottom? Now it's all fixed up. I can go even a little bit further, and just ever so gently, I'm going to bring that right out to show you how to correct something else. Oh no, I covered up all my highlight. What do I do? You don't need to worry. You're going to repeat this, what I just did before. A little bit of white, a little bit of blue, and just lightly touch. And that's it. Okay. Now I am going to want to put a little bit more of that tree color right down here, because it's kind of, I think I avoided that part. I'm just going to put a little bit more in here. Okay. I still see the hilltop right here. So I will end up, while this is dry, once this is dry, just come back and put a little bit more paint. But again, can't just leave the paint on the bottom. I have to fan that out so it looks consistent. Okay. Deep green, a little bit of brown. You may not have to do this. This is just to show you. And just come in and touch that right in there. I'm not going to worry about this part here because it is a lot airier. I can even bring a little bit of the tree trunk the branches come down here a little bit more and just feather that out, because the tree will naturally be darker on the bottom because the light doesn't reach here, like so. Okay. And now we can start working on the bottom now. And the bottom now, depending on how you've painted it, you're really going to be working with the browns and the yellows to start painting in the grass. Now, depending on the shape of your foreground, it could look different than mine. It could be the same as the reference photo included in the kit. It depends on how you did it. And with that, you can use the round brush with this, with some burnt sienna. And really what you're doing is you're going to re-emphasize the shadow. Now, I really don't need to re-emphasize my shadow, but I'm going to do it anyways. And on dry paper. Like so. And just bring that out a little bit. I can make a little bit of a hill, and you can just make the hill by coming out and just swooping it down like that. You don't have to if you don't want to. I like the watercolor paintings that I do to be spontaneous. I can even touch the paper towel a little bit in there just to lift a little bit of that out. Okay, you can come in as well with lemon yellow. And I'm going to apply a whole thing of lemon yellow right over here, because it makes everything look real, like it's sunlit. And again, it depends on whether you want that to be there or not. That's totally up to you. I'm going to put a little bit here. And the lemon yellow actually mixes in with the brown and the green. It's quite lovely. Take a little bit of the burnt sienna and just come back in and create just a little bit more groundwork. And because the paper's wet, everything just flows in quite smoothly. Now, you can put some background trees in here if you want. I got it started, and I want to show you how to do that, but I want this to be dry first. Now, everything's dried, and I'm going to come back in with the purple with a small brush, and I just want to deepen this shadow just a little bit more, just like so. And I can take this, again, same round brush with a little bit of burnt sienna. And I can come in here, this way, and I can put a few little trees back here. Now, you can do this really at any stage of the game. You don't even have to do it, just to show you what it looks like. Then rinse the brush, blot it, and then just come in. Just gonna turn that painting around, and then just soften it. Soften the top edge. Okay, you don't have to if you don't want to. A little bit of yellow, just straighten that out. You can then take some burnt sienna with a little brush, with a dry technique, come in and create a little hill here. Like so. And I can take a little bit of the burnt umber. I have a little bit of sap green already in there, and I'm going to further deepen the shadow in here. It's all about layers when you're painting. A little bit of that lemon yellow. And I want to put a little bit of sun back here. Okay. More yellow and yellow. I really want to emphasize this part here. Now, you can take a little bit of green and to blend that in if you find that it's a little bit too yellow. This is better done when it's wet, because it's grassy areas and it just seems to blend a little bit nicer. And like I said, you can do this painting 25 times and you'll get 25 different results. So experiment and play with the things. It's watercolors are very unpredictable when you're painting. You may follow the directions to the T and it not turn out that way. And it's no fault of your own. It's just, the environment. If like my paper's a little bit warped, that'll affect it. If you dried it too much, didn't let it dry, a little bit too much water in your brush, too much paint, all those factors. And that's why I just keep practicing and practicing and practicing, and you'll end up with something that that you really like. And it's going to take now my final thing, a little bit of burnt umber, and I'm just going to zigzag a little bit in here. I just want to blend, want to knock that down just a little bit. Really shadow, put a very deep shadow in there. Like so. Here we go. So that's that. Now, to sign your watercolor, you can do it with paint or you can do it with a pencil. And I'm going to do mine with a pencil. And all I'm going to do now, once you've done this, you can trim the paper down if you want to frame it. I actually like the deckled edges on the outside. I would actually frame it just like this on. I get a framer to mount it where the edges show. That's just me. So you could do yours a little bit differently. And I would just sign mine with pencil on the bottom. And that's it. But before you do any signatures, take a look at your piece. You can do some extra accents if you want. For example, I could take a little bit of the paint and I could come in here and just put just a few extra little branches in here. Just don't look for stuff to fix, because if you like the way it is, then leave it. And just adding a little bit more detail in here, only because if I had two versions of this, then I could have demonstrated on another version, but I really like the effect that I had on the tree when it was at the point where I wanted to stop. But then I wouldn't be able to show you all the correction detail. But you can come in, add a few extra branches, and all I'm doing is with deep green. And right on the dry paper. And that's actually not too bad. You can come in branch that's really sticking out there, because trees are not perfect. Some trees you've got a lot of action in the trees, a lot of broken branches. Trees are not perfect. And the trees that are more interesting to paint are the ones that are not perfect. There we go. And that's it. Alrighty, so again, watercolors need to be framed behind glass. So once you're all done with touching up, let it dry completely. If possible, let it dry overnight just to, okay, this may be dry, but the water goes through the back of the paper as well. So let it dry overnight, sign it, frame it, and then you're ready to go. So what I have here are two versions of the painting, and I've got this first little one, what I like to call postcard, which is a study based on a concept. And then I thought of something more structured. This resembles more of the sun shelter that I have, except ours is metal. And I saw one like this on a little road trip to the grocery store. It was in somebody's backyard. This is actually really pretty. It was all stained and really, really nice. So I thought I'd use this shape. And this one here, though, it's a little bit more complicated putting the line drawing on the paper, but you simplify it by using a ruler. You don't need to freestyle anything. And with this one here, you can crop it down as much as we want. So I've transferred it, and you see the lines are a little bit darker than what they should be. Okay, this is for video purposes. And I didn't put any details. And so when you're going to do this, you're going to make the lines as light as you can. The brushes, I have two flats and two rounds. These will be different from what you have. I'm using these brushes here because my piece is a little bit larger. I've got water container here, and oh, I'm going to reach over. I have a mister bottle just to spray the paper if necessary. And I've got my palette with the watercolors. And what I have is sap green, deep green, I have Prussian blue, and I'm going to skip the red. I have burnt umber, burnt sienna, and lemon yellow. Now, the red is not in the actual written lesson. It's in the postcard here. And I'm going to show you how to touch in a little bit of the color. And when you put the watercolors down from the tube, this is actually too much. You really only need about that much. Okay, and this is Crimson Red Lake. You don't need a lot, but you will need plenty of water, and keep the water away from your painting. And actually, the palette should even be further away. That way you don't accidentally splash. Video purposes, I'm keeping it together. So the first thing I'm going to do is take your largest brush, and we're going to dampen the paper. And you're going to dampen the outside area of the gazebo. We're going to leave the windows for now. So just take your brush, touch it along the edge. And we're doing this because wherever there's water, the watercolors will seek out the moisture. So they'll naturally spread out. So we do this protect the gazebo. So wherever you don't want paint, because we're starting with blue, you just mask that out. If you have MAC tack, you can use that, cut it out and place it over the gazebo. That'll help mask out the area. And if you down, you know, your travels, you can pick up some masking fluid or masking film at an art store. It's a specialty item. But just with a little bit of control, you can do some really interesting things without it. And tilt your paper sideways a bit so you can see where you've missed some spots. Make sure all the paper is damp. And you don't want the water running down the paper. Just make sure it's damp. And you're going to go across here and across here, which will be an invisible tree line. And we're going to do inside the windows after. So that's pretty good. Okay. You take some water on the palette, a little bit of Prussian blue. And this is how dark you have the sky is completely up to you. And I'm just going to scrub. And where there's going to be clouds, you just don't put any paint. But I'm going to cover everything next. I'm going to show you how you can fit some clouds in there. Be very careful next to the gazebo. And while the paint is wet, take a clean paper towel. I should have told you to have that ready. Clean paper towel and just tap in there. And the paper towel actually removes the paint. Now I'm going to paint that over. Very carefully go along the side. When I get quiet, it's because I'm concentrating. Along the side. And you can apply the paint on the dry paper. Oh, see what happened? It was undiluted pigment in the brush. I just rinsed out my brush. Just push that around a bit. There we go. And when you put the paint in there, you can also drip it or turn it and it'll drip down and create some really interesting patterns. And I'm going to show you how to do that in a second. Watercolors tend to get a little bit lighter as they dry
what I like to do is just make things a little bit darker, unless you're going for a very light, airy feel. Very carefully. There we go. And we just have this one to do. Now the paper here has dried. You can see it has a very different look to it. Yeah, the paper is dried here. How far does that go? I didn't finish the line drawing here. Right there. Okay. And add a little bit more blue. Here. And what this does, this will also help create some trees. I'll show you. I'm just putting a little bit more blue here, very, very watery. And your paper will start to buckle, so there's nothing to worry about. What we're going to do now is tilt the paper this way and watch the paint drip. Let's see now. That's not what I was expecting. I didn't really want 2 points coming up. So I can take some more paint, a little bit more pigment, put that in there. Make sure you have plenty of water though. And when your paper buckles a little bit, which is normal, that will also determine which direction the water flows. Now, see here the little bubbles? That you have to get rid of because that'll actually leave a spot. And as we go down, I'll just tap a little bit more. See that beautiful look? We didn't get much over here, so I'll just, oh, that's too much pigment, too much pigment. So I'll just rinse my brush, a little bit of water. Now the water has seeped into the gazebo a little bit. So what we're going to do is just with clean brush and just going to brush that out. And for this particular case, it's not a big problem because we're going to be putting burnt sienna on there, so it'll darken a little bit. You just don't want it anymore going in there. Towel. Now I'm going to make the paper towel a little bit smaller. You can also use Kleenex for this and just touch, make the clouds nice and small. You even use your finger if the paint's non-toxic. So try to avoid having the same shape for all the clouds. There we go. I think that's pretty good. Now we have to take the task of letting this dry. And let's see if I can wipe that down. There we go. We have to let that dry. If you have a hair dryer, that will speed up the drying time immensely. Let's save a little bit of time. I'm going to take a smaller brush And I'm just going to carefully dampen the windows inside. These aren't really windows, they're just the blank spots. But if you happen to get Prussian blue, like I did inside here, don't worry about it. It'll just help darken the brown. So I'm only going to dampen this one with water. Because in the other ones, I'm going to show you what it's like when it's painted wet paint on dry paper. So we're just going to seep that in there. And the watercolor is seeking out the water. It's spreading out wherever the water is. The watercolor is following. If the watercolor happens to dry out on your palette, no big deal. It's water soluble. You should just mist a little bit more water into it. Let it sit for a couple minutes. It'll be fine. So that's wet on wet. Now, if we just take the pigment, go straight on here, it's a completely different look. It's a little bit more difficult to apply the paint because you're having to work a little bit harder. And if you... when you put the paint on, if you let that dry, then put another layer of paint on top, you're actually going to get some demarcation lines. And in some designs, that's desirable. For what we're painting here, it's fine. I can actually just do something like this with different types of blue or different opacities of blue because these are all background trees. And I set the color of the background trees to be blue because then we can glaze some green over it. And glazing is just adding a transparent color. So you can just... and now that this is wet now with the paint, I can just put a little bit more here. Okay. Make sure that's straight. That's a straight pole. But who's to say this gazebo hasn't seen... its fair share of bad weather. Okay. And this one as well. It's the edges you really have to watch. Bit more. All right, guys, you got some nice patterns going on here. Okay. Now we could go ahead and start painting the gazebo, but the problem with that is if some of the burnt sienna even touches the wet blue, it's going to blend in together. So we need to let this dry 100%. I am, though, going to clean this up. You can clean that up with fresh water and just blotting to pick up that. And then we'll go over it with a Q-tip. That's one thing that's really good to have handy is a Q-tip. I'll get some for the next step. There we go. All right, so if you want to use a hairdryer, just have the hairdryer about 12 inches above and just move it around like this. Lowest setting, lowest air pressure, lowest setting. If you're using a heat gun, keep it between 12 to 14 inches above your paper again. Just keep it moving. Alrighty, so I'm going to use the small round brush. Use whatever brush is comfortable for you, though. I'm going to use a small round brush, and I'm going to work some burnt sienna. Okay, and we're going to apply it on the dry paper. We're not going to wet the paper first. So all we're going to do is just do one section at a time and apply burnt sienna to each part, each element. So the legs, the roof, just do everything separate. That way the colors don't bleed into each other and you won't lose the shape. So I'm just using the tip of the brush to touch the outside edge that I need to, that needs to remain crisp. Okay, so the next part I would do, I would work on this one. This is dry. Very slowly. Around that tip. So we covered off wet on wet. We covered off wet on dry. We did some scrubbing in the sky. We did some tipping. Now, if you want to do some more, not more fun project, but I've got some really little fun activities on my website. The video's at the end, the link's at the end of the video. I've got a whole bunch of little things that you can do in an art journal. Excuse me. Watercolors can be used as well. And we're going to do it with this one. We're going to use graphite though, but you can outline with a pigment liner, which is really nice. Pen and ink. It's called pen and ink, but you're not using old school, was an actual quill pen and a dip with a bottle where you dip the pen, but you can use a liner. See how it dries much lighter? And you want to try, and that's how I'm creating the lines. I'm going over and over, and other than the edges being even, I like how they're the different variety of, some areas are dark, some areas are light, because it makes it look old. That's why I named this Abandoned Gazebo. Okay, now this one's going to be interesting. So see the brown over the blue just makes it a little bit darker. For those of you that have followed my videos, you'll know when I take a blue and a brown, it's to make something called chromatic black, which is making black with color. Other than painting a pupil in an eye, or some reason, I don't like using black, because if used incorrectly, I don't like teaching students to use black, because used incorrectly, it can really dull down your paintings. I like teaching the color mixing. I had to take a bit of a 10-minute break, and I went through a sneezing fit. Apologize. That's one thing I do edit out of my videos though, is when I sneeze. I don't edit out mistakes, so that way you can see how to fix them, but I do edit out when I sneeze. So this now has two layers of burnt sienna. So you'll be able to see the difference. I love that color. This is a very, very simple project. The hardest part of this project, believe it or not, is getting the line drawing on there. All right, so now we're going to continue on. For the top part, just color in everything. Don't worry about the windows. The whole gazebo is all done in burnt sienna. have a major rainstorm going on right now. Outside, very, very warm, humid. So being inside the studio is quite nice. Okay, I'm not going to paint the roof. I'm not going to paint this one because it'll touch into here. Even though it's all the same color, then I just went against what I said. I shouldn't have started here because this will bleed into that. So I'll... talking and painting at the same time. Not my strong suit. Yeah, it's nice being in the studio. And when during the drying times for watercolors, I turn on the fan just so things can get some air circulation. It's not nice having a heat gun going when it's 37 degrees outside. But I will show you. If I wanted to paint this and just went, because this will bleed, hit it with the heat gun just for a couple of seconds. That's it. That's all you need to do. Then come back. There we go. Now doing each section, it'll be consistent. Now for the other side though, I'm going to dilute the paint a little bit more because it's lit up. The sun is actually reaching it. So this will be a little bit lighter. So more water. And the blue didn't quite touch the gazebo. So at the end, when I go over the lines with a graphite pencil, I'll just go on the outside edge. I could come in and touch it with the blue again. But I like the idea of the graphite pencil. It's a nice effect. And this I'm going to kind of model up a little bit more. There we go. And let's do this. So you're going to do the entire gazebo with burnt sienna. Remember, do each element at a time and work the elements independently. We'll be able to see the difference between this one and this one. It's the difference in value. Well, might as well do this part here too. I want this one to be a little bit darker, a bit more paint. This is shadowed. When you're working wet on dry like this, where you have to be careful is depending on how much pressure that you use on the brush, because the paint will go wherever you tell it to go. If you were to wet the paper first, then the paint will only go where it's wet. So you just have to be careful. Whoops, I went a little bit too far there. Okay, I'm gonna grab a Q-tip. Not a big deal, but I went past the line. So I can take a Q-tip and there we go. The floor is going to be brown anyways, so it's nothing to worry about. this, we're going to go over with a darker color. So I can do these, I can do this and this at the same time. But see, when I wiped that out and didn't let it dry, the paint seeped back in there. Didn't go in enough the window, so I will pretend there's a bar there. So paint the entire gazebo, everything burnt sienna. Whoops, I got a little bit on the roof there. Again, no big deal, because the roof, we're going to be deepening the shadow on that. This exercise will really teach you some control. Whereas the single tree design, Solitude, teaches you to be a little bit more expressive. The best way to master is just to keep practicing. Try different things. Although I'm doing this with a round brush, you may prefer using the flat brush, which is so okay. It is perfectly fine. Use whatever brush works for you. Go. And let's see, that's all dry. Put this one here. Go. Okay, take some more burnt sienna, really diluted it, and I'm going to paint this. Everything's with burnt sienna, it's just that when we're darkening the areas, we can add another layer of burnt sienna, or we can add some burnt umber. That's still wet. You could just apply the burnt sienna everywhere and all at once, but wanted to basically get you started learning some control by painting each element independently. And if something happens with the watercolors that you didn't really expect, so paint didn't go where it wanted to go, just go with the flow. Try not to get too upset with it. Watercolors is something very hard to control. I'm going to add another layer. Burnt sienna here, so you can see what it looks like. Another layer of burnt sienna here. Another layer of burnt sienna here. I picked up a little bit more pigment, so it's less diluted. But see how the different colors work together? It's so beautiful. The poles inside here are going to be darker. But you need to make sure that the outside ones are dry. Let's see, that's still wet. That's still wet. Let's see what happens if we don't wait for it to dry. So I'll paint this here. It's diluted. I know the paint's gonna run. But I want to show you with this particular design that you don't need to worry about that. And we'll paint in here. Tidy that up a little bit. Okay. I'll paint another layer of burnt sienna here. So everywhere we want it to be a little bit darker, I'm just going to put a little bit more burnt sienna. But on the second layer, make sure what you're painting is dry. Okay, beautiful, beautiful, beautiful. See how the paint's starting to run? I'm not going to worry about it. I'm going to show you what happened, how you can fix that, because that's a common problem with beginners. So really diluted burnt sienna. The floor. Because this gazebo is made of, I'm going to say, cedar, we can really play with the effects with the burnt sienna, because cedar, you know, the cedar has imperfections as well. So you can get some really nice effects with wood. There we go. Okay, now I'm going to let that dry. And while I'm here, this is all dry here. The bottom row is dry. We can paint with some green. We can paint, use green and paint some grass. So I'm going to take the large round brush and I'm going to wet it. That, how it splashed and it got some water on there, was because I was working too fast. So slow down. Right along there. Now this one here, if you happen to get a little bit of green into the brown, it's not the end of the world, because the gazebo is inset. Same thing up here. If we get some green up here, it's no big deal. And we're painting trees there. But you want to get a good amount of water in here. Let me bring some of that water right up here. So you can see what I was talking about, what I was going to do. Even with a big massive brush, you can still have some control. Make sure that's all wet. Okay, what color are we going to use first? Let's use sap green. You can make a green with yellow and blue, but let's make things easy right now. And I'm just gonna just go over a bit more green. There we go. We're going to be painting green all the way. And this is where you can have some fun. We're going to be layering. So this will have a bit of time to dry. We'll come back in. A little bit more green. Tilt the paper. How natural that looks. And while the grass dries, come back in. Let's put some water. Make sure the gazebo is dry where you're doing this. We're going to paint some background trees now. If you had the masking fluid or masking film, you would put the masking film over the gazebo and just, you can do the whole background independent. You wouldn't have to do it like this. Just tilting, make sure I have. Now I'm going to bring some water lines this way. Let's get some more green. I'm going to make sure that my paper is tilted a little bit. I remember when I watched somebody paint watercolors. It was my first time seeing somebody work with watercolors, and I said, why are you tilting the paper? I didn't quite get what they were doing. Now I do that for almost everything. except oils. I don't do it very frequently with oils. This padding. You'll get a now see where it's not going anywhere? Because there's no water there. There we go. I'm gonna figure out what shape I'm gonna go with. I'm liking that. A bit more water. Bring some of that out like so. Smudge out the water there. And I'm just gonna touch and pad. And this will look like airy tree lines. Get rid of that bubble. Don't forget, when this dries, it's gonna dry a little bit lighter. It's gonna be so airy. Just remember, wet on dry will look completely different. Look how beautiful that is. Holy smokes. But you know what? Something's wrong. Something's wrong. I want to see if you can get what's wrong with this. I'll give you a couple of minutes to think about that. I'm going to add another layer of grass. How am I, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to veer off the line. This written lesson. I love doing this. I'm going to kind of use this as a little bit of red. Red next to green looks so pretty. So I'm just going to. Now we did this wet on dry. Yeah, we'll do that. We'll put a little bit of green underneath. So, did you figure out what's wrong with this painting yet? The windows! We need to put some green inside the windows. I'm going to try with the big brush. I like using the biggest brush possible because I don't get all fuddy-duddy with details. If you're uncomfortable with having, you can't touch the painting because it's still wet. If you're not comfortable with that, let everything else dry. And that green, because there's so much water in it, it'll retain the shapes, the shape of the blue, like how the, all these, this dark here, it'll retain that. But you notice I'm not scrubbing, because if I keep scrubbing, I'm going to dissolve the blue and we'll lose some of those nice, beautiful details. I'm just tickling the paper with the brush. When I work with the students, I'll actually put their hand, and I'll put my hand on top of their hand, and they can feel the pressure. And they go, oh, that is so cool. Here we go. And now while I'm finishing this off, don't forget to visit my website. Again, everything is at the end of the video, where I started off with the website just being strictly art. Now it's more than just that. But there's challenges, ideas, tons of free tutorials. Join the community with a whole bunch of other people. There we go. See how we kept that beautiful variegation in there? That is just gorgeous. All right. So I think at this point now, we're going to let everything dry. And I'm looking to see, can we save some time somewhere? No, not really. everywhere we have to paint, it's too close to the green. So I'm going to let this dry. And when we come back, we'll deepen up the shadows in the gazebo. Then I'm going to show you how to paint some really nice foreground areas with some yellow. And then we'll hit it with a little bit of optional red. So this has had time to dry. Isn't it beautiful? Now, in the written lesson, I added that you can add some shrubbery here with the dark green. And you can still do that. I want to kind of skip ahead and work the grass a bit. Then we'll come back and work this because I also want to deepen the gazebo. So let's work on that first. So to deepen the gazebo, we can take a little bit of burnt umber for that. A little bit of Prussian blue. We know that that's going to make brown and blue make a nice dark color. But I don't want it to be too dark. This actually makes it like an olive green. So I'm going to really dilute that. And I'm going to paint the floor. Wet on dry. Really line that up. Now I will end up getting quiet when I'm concentrating. Okay. Alright, so I got that in there. Now, if I can take a little bit more, come back over again, because now it's wet, it'll seek out and dissolve. It'll blend itself out. Okay. And I'll do that. Oh, I got a little bit in the leg. Not a big deal because we're shadowing this as well. And just a little bit of shadow under here. Because the sun's not hitting this part. Okay. And you can take that same color and we can shadow these support posts. I'm using a round brush. You can use a flat brush if you want. Whatever brush is comfortable for you. And this color will just shadow everything. To refine this a little bit here. I'm going to shadow that hole behind here because it's got lost a little bit. And we're going to let that dry and then we're going to shadow the trim. And let's see, we need to shadow the poles. I'm going to use just burnt umber for that. I'm just going to add very, very, very diluted burnt umber. Very, very diluted burnt umber. This one here. And you don't even have to go all the way across. Like I can start down here, work my way up, and only paint to that, which will look like there's a highlighted post there. You can also Just use burnt sienna if you want to make it a little bit more red. That you can do as well. I find that between the burnt umber and burnt sienna, you get a lot of variety. Oops, that's kind of crooked, isn't it? You get a lot of variety. There we go. I'm going to take a little bit more burnt sienna. Now I can come up here and just work upwards like that. I can leave it. I don't have to paint the whole thing. You can have it where this will be weathered wood. You can leave some of the parts highlighted. You can leave, like here, I can come in here. And not quite finish the whole thing. This I'm going to come in with burnt umber. This needs to be dark. Whoops, it's spreading in there. Oh, what do we do? No problem. That has to be dark anyways. Okay, look at the floor now. It's starting to spread all out there. So let's use that. We'll just spread that out. There is a mark here. I'll just rub that a little bit more. There we go. It's a graphite line that got wet. It's dissolved. There we go. But see when what it looks like? Looks like there's something either in the wood or it's highlighted. And if you don't like it, just cover it up like so. Now the roof, I'm going to come in. Now you can go between the burnt umber and the burnt sienna. In the written lesson, I wrote that it was going to be a Prussian blue burnt umber, but I'm going to change the color up a little bit. I was going to use burnt sienna. And I'm going to work the burnt sienna only on these two panels. All the way across. There we go. And put that half of the cap. Okay, so this is all sunlit. See how easy that is just to add extra shadow? And this looks like this now where it's spreading out, it looks like the roof is just distressed. If you can soften that out by just blending that a little bit more, like so, I can come in, add a little bit more burnt sienna. Now this is wet, so the paint's gonna spread out. Okay, and then when that's dry, we're going to come in with burnt umber along that trim, and I want to also clean up some of the edges with the green. We have to wait for everything to dry. What we don't have to wait to dry is when I come in with the graphite, we'll do that at the end. Let's work the foreground. So while all that's drying, take a little bit of lemon yellow and just come in and add a little bit of a glaze, which is a transparent layer. This is where it's just highlighted. Okay. Now you can do this if you want. I'm just going to show you. I'm just taking a little bit of crimson. Now red and green together make a very dull color, so that's why I left it light here, and you can just add that in Okay, and then just feather that out like so. What it looks like is a little path. I can come with a little bit more yellow. There we go. See? Nice little hit of pink. Well, we don't have to wait for it to dry, so we want to create some brush, some bushes. Now, if we take the sap green, the dark green, I should say, a lot of water. You want to come in, make sure that wherever you're painting that the gazebo is dry. I'm going to go right next to this. There's some little spots of paper showing. And that's what happens when you use paper that's it's cold pressed paper, so it's very rough. So there's a lot of texture. Okay, a little bit more water. Tilt. It might need a little bit of help. And let's just get something happening here. Blot the brush too, so you can help make some little lines. There we go. Now I can go into a little bit of Prussian blue and just blend right on the painting. That'll create some dark pockets there. Same thing on the other side, but instead of the dark green, I'm going to use the sap green because this area is lighter. I don't know if it'll have enough. No, the paper's curling down this way, so I'm going to tilt it while I paint. A little bit of Prussian blue. That yellow wasn't dry. And we'll just guide the paint. We'll just touch in a little bit more. You don't need a lot because now we're just layering just additional details. Make sure you do the any areas behind the little cap so it doesn't look like you painted around it. There we go. Nice, beautiful. This tree's a little crooked. I'm not going to worry about that. Then down here, let's take some of that deep green. And come in right underneath the gazebo where it would be really dark. Take a lot of water and blend that right out. Now we're going to some diluted sap green. Avoiding the red. There we are. So as each layer dries, you can manipulate it with some interesting little shapes just by touching and patting. Okay. We have to let this dry now. Can't do any more work on it because the background is so wet. I think there's just a couple of things left to do. We're going to color in the windows. We'll darken up some of the shadows in the gazebo. And we'll paint in a few birds. Okay, so everything's dried now. I'm going to take the small brush, and now all we're doing is tidying up. And I'm going to use the burnt sienna, and I'm going to tidy up areas that I want to be shadowed. So just the inside edge of the poles. There. And this one's going to receive another layer. Not too much. Make sure you've got water in there. Just diluting that a little bit more. Touch into a little bit of the burnt umber. Come back in, redefine that support beam. If you wanted to make this out of like a wrought iron one, just use Prussian blue and burnt umber instead of burnt sienna. And that'll make it look like it's wrought iron. Okay. And the windows, the flat brush is too big, so I'm going to use this small little round brush with burnt umber. And in the written lesson, these windows are actually transparent. I want these to actually be windows, like full windows, like what we have. So you just make little boxes. This brush is a little bit big for that. You can make little boxes. Dissolve that out there. Okay. We're going to come in with our graphite pencil to outline, which is optional. You don't have to. Okay, burnt umber on the trim very carefully. Turn around if I can get the edge. Here, this is all in shadow. Alrighty. And I can come in with a little bit. I'll use sap green because it's much lighter. You can come in and just tidy up anywhere where there's a little bit of paper showing. But then you have to kind of build that in to the design. You can't just touch in the sides and leave it. Like here. Actually, let me find a place that's dry. I have to come in right to the edge to cover up the white. But then I have to do something with that. I can't leave it like that. So I'll just come in and just brush some of that color. Dry brush. Make sure I get rid of that line. Like so. And I have to bring that color here right to the very edge. Right here. And that happens, so don't fret if you didn't quite get to all, like if you have some of the edges that have the paper showing, it happens all the time. Okay. Put a little bit more paint there. And just work that in. Okay. We have a little bit in here. Actually, we have quite a bit in here. I know of some artists that I'm friends with, they will actually leave the white of the speckled edges. That's optional. You can do that as well. You don't have to completely cover everything. Just tidying up. And the sap green is transparent, so we're not going to lose any effects. But I'm going to create a little bit more of an effect. Straighten this out. And pounce that in. I love that. One of the things I really like about watercolors is that depending on how much water you put into it, you can work it like acrylics. I can pounce, I can dry brush. use it thin, use it thick. Take a paper towel, pounce, pounce, pounce. Like here. If I wanted to create a little bit of something in here, I could just tap. And let's see. As I go around, burnt umber, very little water. I'm going to take a little bit of Prussian blue there. I want to make that more gray, because this would be worn out. Okay. And I think that's pretty well covers that. There are some little spots here with some burnt sienna, some spots missing. No biggie. All right, I'm gonna let that dry because now we're gonna come in with the graphite after, but let's get some little birds in. You can paint the birds with paint. I find it just easier to do it with a sharp graphite pencil. Like so. And when you outline the gazebo, whoops, I dropped my scissors. Outline the gazebo, everything has to be dry, and all you're going to do with your sharp pencil, come in and go over each element. You have to let this dry first though. All right. For the outlining, again, you don't have to do this. This is completely optional. And I'm going to go over each element. Now you can do it freehand or do it with a ruler. That's completely up to you. And I'm going to go over freehand. So I'm just going to gently outline each element. You can do this with a pigment liner as well. Find a permanent liner. There's only one part I'm going to use the ruler for. I want to get these put in first. And that goes down here. And that goes... that pole, I'm trying to have to look at my reference piece here. This goes all the way down like that. Okay, and then this pole. And for the pen and ink technique, you'd be just doing the same thing, except using a permanent liner. The graphite just adds a little nice little edge to it. I used to teach reverse glass, where you would paint, do a drawing like this on plexiglass with a special liner that we carry, and then you would paint the oils on the plexiglass, but in reverse. So that what the person saw wasn't the painted side, it was the back side. And that was a lot of fun. You can also use watercolor pencils to do this stage. And as you're doing this, don't forget to step away from your piece, look at it from a distance. Right now we're just looking at it from one angle, which is up close. Things look differently when you're away from it. Okay, we're almost done. Pencil starting to dull out just a little bit, but we'll be fine. All right, and then we'll do this part. See, this is where you can cover up some of those white little speckles. in the windows. Okay. And each panel, the panel here. Okay, I think we got everything right. Oh, there's a panel here, the panel here, and then there's a go. What have I missed? The floor. And then I'm gonna put some planks inside here. That I'm gonna use the ruler for. It depends on how many you wanna put down. I can put one here. Here, here, almost half in size. And you can measure them out. That's totally up to you. I'm just basically distributing the lines across. Another one here. There we go. How awesome is that? And then all that's left really is just to sign your name. I did see a little smudge here, and I think it's because it wasn't quite dry. So I'll just, with a little bit of water, try not to go over the graphite. A little bit of, this is where you're, when you're painting with wood, not when you're painting wood, but when you're painting wood, you can be really flexible as to the effect of what you're painting. And I'm just bringing back a memory of the cedar benches that Joe built for me. They're weathered right along the bottom, along the edge of each supporting piece. So you know what? I'm going to do that. Just make sure I have a little water. I'm going to do that. They're darker. That'll look weathered. There we go. Okay. Then you sign it. Now you can actually, this is actually quite nice with the torn edges. You can trim it and then frame it, but it has to go behind glass. So you can't put it up on the wall like this because it's water soluble. It'll get ruined if it gets wet. So I'm just going to sign it. And that's it.
So we're all done. Did you have fun? I hope so. Now the only way to improve your skills is to practice, practice, practice. And to help you with that, I'd like to invite you to visit my website at myloveaffairwithlife.com. And what you'll find on there is a variety of things that are for creative inspirations, free tutorials, free videos, full classes and workshops that you can try, different mediums, a whole bunch of different things. And basically, if you're on that website, you will never be bored because there's always something to do. All right, so I'd like to invite you to check that out. And I really hope that you will push along and practice the skills that you've learned so far. Visit the website, get a whole bunch of different other information to help you along. And I would love to get your feedback. And on the website, you can sign up for my newsletter. I announce different projects that are free tutorials and stuff like that. And I would love to see the artwork that you've created in today's workshop. So until then, stay inspired, and I will see you next time.